Hits with the Shadow.
And now here's a special report on a rock star who's using his fame to try and literally save the earth. His one-word name is world famous, Sting. And Sting has become part of the movement to save tropical rainforests. Now, what are the rainforests? Well, they cover only 7% of the world, but scientists say you'll find up to two-thirds of the world's oxygen-producing plants and trees in them. There are people who are trying to make it better, and they belong to several rainforest alliances and protection groups. And that's where Sting comes in. He's a co-founder of the Rainforest Foundation. And recently, Sting met with French President François Mitterrand to set up a fund to have one of the rainforests in Brazil declared a national park so it can never be destroyed. Sting told the Brazilian Indian tribes there, "You are the protectors of the forest, and if the forest dies, so does the earth. I promise you that whenever I can speak on your behalf, I will do so." Sting has also filmed public service announcements in 8 languages, and he's traveling around the world now to talk about the rainforest problem. That's a special American Top 40 report.
American Top 40.
I'm Shadoe Stevens. A brooding piece of introspective sound and thought. That's what critics have called the new album, Soul Cages, by Sting. Well, we recently had the chance to sit down with the Stingmeister and talk about the album in an exclusive AT40 interview. And we told him the first thing we noticed is that he's telling a lot more stories in his songs. And Sting says there's a reason for that.
Because I spent a lot of time in the jungle with so-called primitive tribes, you know, I lived with them for a while. People were expecting me to do an album that was kind of based on co-opting their music or subjects about them, whatever. You spend time with them, and every night you get around a fire. There's no TV in the jungle, of course, and they tell stories about their ancestors, where they came from, and the whole history. That fascinated me and inspired me to look into my own background. What's my tribe? And I come from the north of England. It's where the Norse people settled. They were great storytellers, too. So I started to read old folk tales from my own tribe, and a lot of the album is this idea of trying to tell a story in a sort of mythic way. I found this old story called The Soul Cages, which is a story about the souls of the dead being kept by an old fisherman in lobster cages under the sea. And the legend is that to free the souls of the dead, you have to go under the sea, drink with the fisherman. If he drinks you under the table, he keeps you forever. If you drink him under the table, the souls go free.
Well, Sting also told us the story behind the song at number 8 this week, the story behind the first single from Soul Cages.
My father was one of the primary inspirations for the record, and I wanted to write something for him and dedicate it to him. The single All This Time is very, it's a bit deceiving, actually. It's quite a jolly little tune. What it does is actually disguises quite a dark and macabre story about a guy who whose father dies, and instead of being satisfied with the ritual that's being served up to put him away, he wants to bury him at sea. Just kind of a sort of black humor attached to it. So it does hide a sort of darker irony beneath the sort of jolly exterior. So do I.
Hi, this is Sting, and you're tuned to the biggest countdown show in the world, American Top 40 with DeShadow.
What'd you say? Say what?
American Top 40!
Oh.
And this guy, number 26, grew up hating rock and roll, till he was about 25, anyway. He's originally from England, Wallsend, Newcastle, an industrial town, coal mining. His father was a milkman, his mother was a hairdresser, and they lived in a sort of rundown part of town. And he figured music could help him get out, but not rock. He told us, "I never liked rock music. When I started playing bass, I played a lot of jazz, Dixieland, mainstream, and modern jazz. I thought playing jazz made me better than people who played rock." So one night he was playing with the jazz combo in a small Newcastle club. During a break, a guy came up from the audience to talk to him. His name was Stuart. He played drums in a band of his own. He needed a bass player and somehow convinced him to join, even though it wasn't jazz. It was definitely rock. Okay, maybe a new kind of rock. Anyway, this drummer, Stuart Copeland, called that band the Police. The bass player discovered rock had its merits, its material rewards. He's one of the world's biggest rock stars. He's here at number 26 on AT40. Here's Sting.
Hi, this is Sting, and these are Billboard's biggest hits on American Top 40.
Right you are, sir. And you've got one of them. If I Ever Lose My Faith in You climbs a notch and leads off AT40's Top 10 this week.
American Top 40.
And now I see by the old clock on the wall, it's time for another sampling of infotainment. Yes, my friends, it's this week's...
AT40 Music
News. In one of the oddest stadium tours this spring, Sting is going to be opening for the Grateful Dead. Sting says, I want to see this deadhead phenomenon firsthand. I'll be playing to a large audience who probably never even heard of me. Such a crazy idea. Sting's first date with the Dead is May 14th in Las Vegas.
American Top 40!
Shadows off and I'm in. Hello, this is Martha Quinn, and now let's get on with the business at hand, shall we? Next at number 5, it's Sting and his latest hit, If I Ever Lose My Faith in You. AT40 had a chance to sit down and talk with Sting and ask him about something he knows a bit about. Songwriting.
Well, I think the germ of an idea will come at you like that, you know, when you're relaxed and maybe you're not expecting anything to happen. But then again, to craft a song from that germ takes a lot of effort and a lot of work. So a song will write itself, but the actual nuts and bolts that hold the song together, you know, the harmony and the structure of the song and lines that rhyme with other lines and writing bridges and middle eights, that takes a lot of work. So don't get the idea that it's a magical process. It is a magical process just to begin with, and then you have to craft it.
American Top 40.
It's hard to imagine some people ever struggling, like Sting, for example. He was a school teacher in Newcastle, taught classes during the day, and played bass in jazz bands at night. He was doing pretty well for himself and his first wife and their child. He told us, I'd become a celebrated figure in Newcastle. I wasn't rich, but I was comfortable, had a salary, a pension. Then I began to feel the parameters of possibility. So we left hometown comfort and moved the family down south to the big city, London. But it didn't immediately work out like he planned. He says, we spent 6 months on people's floors without any prospect of work. I signed on with welfare, got 16 pounds a week, and we had to eat a lot of carrots. I found myself saying to myself, you're living like a hobo. You're educated. What are you doing? Luckily, one of those floors he slept on belonged to an entertainment agent who started getting him commercials. And then Sting says, one day my wife told me that a film called Quadrophenia was being cast. I went to the audition and got the part and did 2 more small parts. And also around that time, the police started and I had a parallel career going. From a few carrots to a full plate. It's a great story. And number 8 on AT40, here's Sting.
Top 40.
Fields of Gold, the latest by Sting. And he's got back-to-back hits this week on American Top 40. At number 36, his recent top tenor, If I Ever Lose My Faith in You. Those are both from his album 10 Sumner's Tales. And he didn't do that album in a recording studio. And he explains why.
I really don't like studios very much. I find them sort of prison-like environments, you know, where you don't see the air or breathe the air or see sunlight for months on end. So I decided I'd make a record at home, you know, with the kids around. So I moved everybody out of the dining room and moved this equipment in. And the kitchen is next door, so we had another smell of food going most of the day. And we could, you know, walk out in the garden, open the windows, and just live a real life instead of a sort of fake environment that the studio gives you, you know. Made us happier, basically.
American Top 40!
The Shadow, which you ought to wait at the top. And next at number 29, it's the current solo hit for Sting. He's been solo since 1985, but even he knows we'll all never forget what he did with the Police, and we asked him about that.
I'm very proud of being in the Police, I have to say it. I listened to the Greatest Hits album the other week. It's relentless, you know, hit after hit. So I think I'm very proud of that, you know. I'm proud of my association with those guys, Andy and Stuart. I'm just glad I'm still around, you know. I think it was a good idea to finish at the top. I just knew it was the right thing to do.
You remember me.
American Top 40.
For Shadoe Stevens, we're DeLane Matthews and Harry Anderson.
You know, you could call the man at number 37 the rainforest rock star. He's done more to protect and preserve rainforests than anyone else in music. Now, if you've wondered if there's been any progress, Sting has some positive news to report.
We had a very big success in that what we've been
trying to do for almost 5 years was demarcate an area of the Brazilian jungle as Indian land. We got the Brazilian government to recognize it constitutionally as Indian land. This is a huge area the size of Switzerland. We then used the money we collected to put beacons around the perimeter, which are linked to a satellite which monitors the perimeter. So anytime there's an incursion or a burning, the satellite can read it, and then they tell the Indians who police the area themselves. Having done that, we want to carry on doing it, because we could do that again, but we need money.
American Top 40!
At 96 for the year, it's a song by Sting, and he told us all about Fields of Gold.
Well, I moved to the country for the first time in my life in England, and there are barley fields right next door. And I remember walking through one day and seeing this crop being moved by the wind and the sunshine, and it looked like one that could have been people making love in the barley, or the wind could have been, you know, the wind seemed like it was making love to the barley. So that was a great metaphor for love, and I don't know, it's a kind of love song.
You remember me.
American Top 40.